My name is Philip Kuklich, and on behalf of my colleagues and collaborators here at Washington University School of Medicine in St. Louis, I'm honored to share with you the results from the longer-term follow-up of our phase one, phase two study of EP-guided non-invasive cardiac radioablation for the treatment of ventricular tachycardia, a study that we call ENCORE VT. Now, as heart rhythm specialists, many of us at HRS perform procedures with catheters, and we carefully maneuver these within and around the heart, meticulously trying to find the critical short circuits of electricity. And once those circuits are identified and discovered, we apply energy at the tip of the catheter, which creates heat to destroy the electrical conduction through these circuits. However, heat from a catheter is limited, and often we can't reach the deeper elements of the circuit within the heart muscle, and so our procedures can fail. So to deliver a full-thickness, gap-free ablation, we look to our radiation oncology colleagues, that's right, our cancer doctors, who have the exact same goals when they're trying to treat tumors. Now, in the basement of most hospitals, you'll find cancers being treated with stereotactic body radiotherapy, or SBRT. Now, this concept, X-rays or photons, are delivered by a robotic arm and sweeping arcs around the patient, delivering high doses of ablative energy to a tumor with minimal exposure to the surrounding tissues. In short, cardiac radioablation, we simply treat an arrhythmia circuit like a tumor. Now, in 2007, we reported the first case series using focused cardiac radioablation in 5 patients with refractory VT. And based on these results, we opened a formal prospective phase one, phase two trial to answer the following question. In patients with VT who have failed conventional therapies, can a single non-invasive radiation treatment safely reduce VT burden? Now, the long-term results of this trial are shared here at HRS 2020. So who was included in this study? Well, in general, the 19 patients in this trial had weak hearts and advanced cardiomyopathy. They had a median of 96 episodes of VT requiring rescue from their defibrillator in the 6 months before the treatment. And all of them had failed standard therapies such as antiarrhythmic medicines or catheter ablations. Overall, compared to other clinical trials of catheter ablations, this was a very sick patient population. Now, the median target size for ablation was 25 cc's. And to provide some element of reference, a golf ball is about 45 cc's. But after we account for the cardiac motion and the respiratory motion and setup uncertainties, the actual treated volume was more than 90 cc's, and their median treatment time was only 15 minutes. The first question that we sought to answer, is this safe? And the answer appears to be yes. We're now reporting the results out past 3 years. Now, acutely, the treatment itself is short and entirely non-invasive, and there were no problems with the cardiac devices, both during and after treatment. And patients are treated as outpatients. So literally they get up after treatment and they walk out of the treatment unit and go home. In the first 90 days of analysis, one patient developed inflammation of the pericardium called pericarditis. And this was treated successfully with a short course of oral steroid medication. Over the next 3 years, we saw two more patients who had developed fluid around their heart called a pericardial effusion, and both of these were easily treated with colchicine, an anti-inflammatory medication. Importantly, one patient developed a gastropericardial fistula just after 2 years after treatment, and this was very near the area that we had treated in the heart on the inferior wall of the left ventricle. This patient presented with abdominal pain. We were able to make the diagnosis quickly, and this patient underwent a successful corrective surgery. Now, to date, no patients have developed heart block. There's been no coronary artery injury. There's been no cardiac perforation. In general, this appears to be a gentle ablation for patients. And this is reflected, I think, in the overall survival. When you look at 6 months in this very sick population, 89% of patients were still alive at 6 months, which is really superb when you think about this patient population. And over half the patients remain alive at 2 years. Now, what about the second question? Is it effective? Well, in this study, this is the first formal study, we chose to look at any reduction in VT burden as our primary endpoint. And we compared the 6 months before treatment to the 6 months after treatment. So at 6 months, 94% of our patients met the trial's primary endpoint. And then continuing that out to 2 years, which we're reporting here, 78% of patients continue to meet that primary endpoint of VT reduction. And again, that's not a fair comparison of 24 months after to the 6 months before. and yet the numbers are still fairly impressive. Now, it's important to put this into some context, though. Most patients were not free of VT. We were not seeking to cure VT with this. It's a difficult bar to achieve in a salvage patient group, and that wasn't the purpose of our study. We will report a number of pre-specified secondary endpoints, and perhaps the most impactful for patients. In the 6 months after treatment, 78% of patients did not have a single ICD shock, and this was in the face of de-escalating antiarrhythmic medicines. Many patients were off antiarrhythmics entirely. So in conclusion, this report is really the first long-term follow-up of non-invasive cardiac radioablation, which is critical because we know radiation can have late adverse effects. And in patients with VT who failed conventional therapies, a single non-invasive 15-minute focused radiation treatment safely reduced VT burden. And this effect persisted beyond 2 years for most patients. So far, the serious toxicities appear to be low, but they can occur out to 2 years and beyond. So long-term vigilance is really needed for future trials. And so right now, based off of these results presented here at HRS 2020, we believe that cardiac radioablation is currently best suited for high-risk patients who have failed conventional VT therapies. Well, I think as we've looked past the last 3 years now, we've seen multiple case reports and now four different case series published that have all generally shown the same thing, that with a single dose of cardiac radioablation, we see a dramatic reduction and a relatively early reduction in VT burden in some of the worst cases. This now needs formal follow-up in a prospective randomized trial, and we're organizing this trial now with the hopes of opening this in Q1 2021.